And as we have reported, the bill passed by the Senate would push billions of dollars toward boosting clean energy projects and combating global warming. William Brangham has more on what is being described as potentially America's first major climate law.
That's right, Judy. If this passes the House and the president signs it into law, it will be by far the biggest investment the federal government has ever made to tackle climate change. According to several estimates, this initiative could produce a 40% reduction in America's carbon emissions by 2030. That's compared to 2005 levels. So for some context, I'm joined by Paul Bledsoe. He's a strategic advisor at the Progressive Policy Institute and president of Bledsoe and Associates. It's a policy firm that specializes in climate change. He's also worked on several international climate change treaties. Paul Bledsoe, great to have you on the program. We just heard Brian Deese, the president's economic advisor, say that this bill, if it becomes law, puts America on a path to meet its climate commitments. Is that true? Is this that substantial?
It comes very close. It will reduce U.S. CO2 emissions by about 40% this decade by 2030, which is a huge amount of progress, and the administration deserves real credit for it. But it is important to note that the U.S. is only 15% of total global emissions. One of the things this bill has to do is begin to lead the American economy, to lead the world in clean energy production, and put pressure and opportunity on nations around the world to clean up their economies and grow their clean energy sectors. For example, China has 30% of global emissions, twice what the U.S. does, and just withdrew from bilateral talks on climate change. So this bill has to not only grow the U.S. clean energy economy, but begin a global transition.
A lot of the pieces within this bill are tax incentives. They're carrots as opposed to sticks to encourage utilities and cities and individuals to move in this direction. Is it your understanding that those incentives are enough to encourage this process to start really moving aggressively?
Thanks, William. It's a really important point. This is not about government spending. This is about providing consumers and businesses incentives to make big investments. We're talking about trillions of dollars over the next decade in a brand new clean energy sector that's going to create millions of new jobs and save consumers thousands of dollars a year. This is going to re-energize much of the American private sector economy. So this is in very much a market approach to getting the private sector making these large investments that will make the United States much stronger in terms of our energy security, our overall economy, and reduction in greenhouse gas emissions.
I want to ask you a political question, because it is striking how virtually the entire GOP was hostile or dismissive to any real substantive action on climate change. And public opinion polling on climate change seems to waffle as to how important it really is to voters. And yet, these very substantial climate provisions have endured for almost a year. How do you account for that?
You know, it's interesting. Formerly, Democrats proposed energy taxes, that is carbon taxes, to deal with the climate problem, and those were politically unpopular. Now, however, Democrats have finally hit on a tremendously popular set of policies: tax cuts for businesses and consumers for clean energy. These are favored by Republicans, Democrats, and independents in all polling. I think the Republicans have made a huge mistake in underestimating how much the business community and average Americans want these new technologies. And I think that if Democrats are smart, they'll run on this pro-business, pro-economic platform of clean energy in the midterms.
Let's say that this goes through. You and others have said this is certainly not the be-all and end-all. It's not like we'll have solved the problem overnight. What are some other steps you would like to see the administration take going forward?
Thank you. It's a great question. One thing that Senator Schumer committed to as part of these negotiations, including with Senator Manchin, was that we would look at permitting reform for U.S. infrastructure. Right now, it's extremely difficult to put up the big power lines we need to move clean energy from the places where we can cheaply generate it to the places where we can use it. We also need more pipelines for natural gas so that we can completely eliminate coal. And we're going to need to export gas so that we can help the rest of the world eliminate coal. There's a lot of other work to be done. Another area is methane emissions. Methane is a super pollutant 80 times more powerful than CO2 and is the key to controlling near-term temperature increases. This bill creates about a $1.5 billion fund to mitigate methane from the oil and gas sector, which is important, but much more needs to be done on these non-CO2 pollutants, which are a key to limiting near-term temperatures and preventing runaway warming in natural systems.
All right, Paul Bledsoe of the Progressive Policy Institute, thanks so much for being here.
Thanks so much.